The Western Hognose Snake is quickly becoming one of the most popular pet snakes in the entire pet trade. And that's for good reason. If you're thinking to yourself that you want to get yourself a Hognose Snake, today we're going to tackle a complete care guide, everything you need to know about the Western Hognose Snake. I'm Adam, this is Wicked's Wicked Reptiles, stick around. New to snakes or not, this is a great species to have because it's very unique. It's a lot different than a lot of other species, so it gives that cool factor that some snakes might be missing for you. And it's fun no matter what you want in a snake. Do you like to handle your snake? Do you like to look at your snake? Do you like your snake to have a grumpy attitude and a shovel face? Well, this is the snake for you. Western Hognose Snakes are medium-bodied diurnal snakes. They're colubrid type of snakes from kind of the Midwest. Basically, if you're looking at Canada, Alberta, Saskatchewan, Manitoba, and then you're going to go all the way down to the bottom of the United States in that same type of region, right through the middle of the country, or you could look right here if you're more interested, and parts of northern Mexico as well. So before we get into the care guide, if you're thinking, can I own one of these things? Because that is a question I get a lot on this channel. It depends. I mean, if you're from Saskatchewan in Canada, probably not. I mean, there's different bylaws in different areas, but if you're in a state or a province that has these as a native species, I would check with your local bylaw officer before you go out and purchase one. It might not be legal for you to keep. Let's get into it. Size is one thing you want to consider, right? If you want to get an animal, you have to know how big it gets. And these are pretty small in terms of colubrid type of snakes. What I mean by that is males and females are different sizes. They are sexual dimorphic. And something that I got wrong in the first care guide for Western Hognose Snakes is the tail sexing, how to sex with the tail. As they get a little bit older, even some people will say out of the egg, if you've got a really good eye for this, you can tell if they're a male or female just by the length and shape of their tail. Males will have longer, skinnier tails, and this is because that's where their hemipenes are stored, and females will have fatter, shorter tails. I got this wrong in the first video. This is the correct way to sex. And also with size, males are a lot smaller than females are. In general, the Western Hognose Snake, you're going to see them get anywhere between a foot and a half at full-grown males to 3 feet or just shy of for full-grown females. My female here, Ekins, she is full-grown. She is about 350 grams, which is pretty much normal for a female. You want to make sure they get a little bit bigger than 300 before you breed her. She just dropped her first clutch of eggs not too long ago. We've got some babies, like you can see right here. And then this is Arbok. Arbok is a male. Now, he doesn't look a ton smaller, but when you pick him up, he feels like a skeleton compared to her in terms of weight. He is definitely a lot smaller. I would say he's about 150 grams, which is actually pretty big for a Western Hognose male. And then we've got Nikki here, who's also a full-grown male, and he's barely 100. I think he's right around 80 grams. And he's actually been eating really good for me lately. The first couple of years, he was kind of picky on and off, which is something we'll get to at the end of the video. But in general, you're going to see a foot and a half to 3 feet. That is the average for this type of snake. And then in terms of weight, 45 grams for smaller males. And then some people say up to 800 grams for larger females, but I've yet to see one over 550 grams. So on average, I would say 35 to 400 grams is kind of where you're going to be. Now, you know how big these things get. How big of an enclosure do you need? This is pretty important, right? Well, it's really simple. For both of these snakes, in terms of female or male, you can get away with a 20-gallon aquarium or equivalent. And this is one of the snakes where it's actually okay, I think, in my opinion, to have them in a glass terrarium. I suggest maybe putting some paper on the side so they feel more secure. But they have a screen top, and that's good because they need a lower type of humidity, which we're going to get into next. What I suggest, though, what I would prefer to see is a 30 or 40 gallon breeder, which really have the same floor space. It's just the height is the difference with the 40. But you don't need a lot of height with these guys. You're not going to find them climbing too much. I've given all my hognose opportunities to climb, and I've really never seen them more than 3 or 4 inches off of the ground. So they're mostly a terrestrial snake. So you're not going to really have to worry about height, but floor space is what I would suggest. 18 by 36 in terms of floor space is great. You only need about a foot if you really want for height. You can always, you know, raise it if you want. Just make sure that your heating is on point if you're going to use a bulb from the top. And a lot of people will keep these guys in tubs, of course. I keep a couple of mine in tubs just because they're my breeding pair. And I truly do believe that they eat better and they respond better to breeding in tubs. Probably just because they feel a little bit more secure. In terms of tubs, I would suggest a 28 quart is perfect for a male or a female. If you want to go up to a 41, no harm there. Just make sure that they can feel secure, they're eating properly and everything else. Heat and humidity is very important with every species that you'll ever keep of any animal, especially if it's a reptile, right? So here is pretty simple with these guys. Of course, you want a thermal gradient. You're going to want the hot side to be hotter than the cool side, obviously. So here's what I would suggest. On the hot side or the warm side, you're going to have your basking spot, right? So your basking spot, you can use an undertank heater, or you can use something that emits heat, like a halogen light bulb, for example. That's what I like to use for my boy Nikki here. He's been a lot more fun to watch since I took him out of a tub and put him into an enclosure like this, where he's getting a really great day and night cycle. I don't have UVB on him, but I do have that light bulb, so he uses it as a basking spot. I see him on this log all the time basking, and his hot spot is right around 94 to 96, depending on how hot the rest of the room is. But that's pretty much perfect, in my opinion, and from all the research I've ever done, of course, take this as a guide, a care guide. This isn't, if I say it's 96 degrees, but it's only 94 on the hot side, on the basking spot, your snake will die. That's not what I'm saying. These care guides are care guides. Stay within the parameters, are pretty darn close, and you're A-okay. So basking spot, 95-ish, something like that. And then on your hot side, the ambient temperature on the warm side of the enclosure, what I like to do is high 80s. So even if it gets into the low 90s, no harm, no foul, because these guys do come from places like Texas, where it's easily going to be 90s during the day. But of course, they come from places like Saskatchewan, where in the middle of Saskatchewan, if it gets to 85 in the day, those people are losing their minds, taking their bunny hugs off because it is so warm. And then you're gonna have a cool side. And the cool side, I would say mid 70s is great. If it gets up to the high 70s, it is what it is. That's not a problem. As long as your thermal gradient gives them enough of a temperature gap or enough of a difference between the cool side and the warm side, I think you're good to go. So, like I said, this is a guide. Those are the parameters. And of course, humidity is a big thing as well. And with humidity, because these guys come from the plains and in Canada, up north of the US, and they come from places where it's rather sandy and rocky and kind of arid in the south, such as Texas, for example, you're gonna want a lower humidity. That is the best bet. So I would suggest 30 to 50%, and that's why I said that screen tops, like aquariums, would be great for this species, because you want the water to evaporate out of the enclosure rather than like with the PVC, where it would just kind of stay inside of the enclosure, which is why I keep ball pythons and skinks in these PVCs, and I don't keep hognose snakes in these PVCs, because you're keeping a bunch of species all in the same room, like Erwin here, who's an Indonesian skink who needs 70 to 80% humidity, which it keeps perfectly the way that I keep them. And then, of course, right on top of them, literally, you've got a hognose snake where you need your humidity to be 50 to 30, and his is about 44 right now, so it's getting kind of high, but I did just put a bunch of water in the bowl. You have to be able to accommodate for that. So keep that in mind, because if they get too high, you're gonna have respiratory infections likely in these animals. In lighting, UVB, a lot of people will say this is the only snake in the world that needs UVB. And I wouldn't totally disagree. I don't think that they need a UVB light, but they do have an issue with calcium in their eggs when they produce eggs. And I've never seen any other snake like this, where the females will have lots of windows in the eggs where they don't calcify properly, especially newer breeders like Ekins here, who had a bunch of issues with her eggs this year, or her first time ever laying eggs. And then their second clutch in the season two, I've heard. So I would suggest, if you have UVB and you don't mind spending the extra money, that'd be great. A lower type of UVB, like a 5.0, you don't need like a desert bulb for these guys, although they do come from the desert. I think a supplement of UVB would be great, although not completely necessary. What is necessary though is a day-night cycle, very minimum, 12 light, 12 dark. I like to go closer to 16 hours of the light and then 8 hours of the dark, but I do cycle them because I do breed them. Inside of this 20, 30, 40 gallon aquarium or whatever it is you're gonna keep your snake, you need a substrate, right? Now this is something that a lot of people will say hognose snakes need a loose substrate because they do have that shovel face, and the reason they have that is for digging and burrowing. I don't think you need a loose substrate. I prefer it. I think it's more natural. I do see my hognose snakes burrowing all the time. All the fixtures in Nikki's enclosure, he'd rather bury under than actually go through the opening that was created in it. So I think it's better for the animal to have a loose substrate. And I use, depending on if it's an enclosed type thing like a tub, I'll use aspen because I think it keeps the humidity a little bit drier. If it has a screen top and has a place for the water to go to evaporate, I like to use an EcoEarth substitute. Beyond Peat is what I use, just a coconut core, because you can mist it down so that part of it is a little bit moister, especially when they're shedding, which is something I suggest too. You might want to have a humid hide for when they're shedding, but don't keep it in there all the time unless you can keep the humidity just right. Babies, like smaller individuals, especially really young ones, like you'll see here, this is literally 3 weeks old, this animal. I keep them on paper towel. I don't think impaction is going to be a big issue with any snake really, but and not hognose for sure. But I think it's safer just in case. These are very small animals. They have very small bodies. It's just easier to keep them on paper towel, in my opinion, until they get a little bit bigger. A few more things you'll also need inside of the enclosure. Nothing major. Two hides, of course. You want one on the hot side, one on the cool side, so they can hide and feel safe. Snakes oftentimes feel a lot safer when they're hidden. And that way you can give them the option of being hidden in the cool end or the warm end, right? Depending on what they're doing. Especially if you've just let them eat. I mean, they want to be hidden so they can digest that food in a warm environment. That's just what I would suggest for the two. And you could always have that humid hide as well, which I'd put on the hot side. That would be a good idea. You can just use something as simple as a sandwich container with a hole cut in the lid and then sphagnum moss inside of it. That's what I do. And the reason I have this one in this enclosure is because you can see Arbok is shedding. He's got those blue caps on his eyes. It's called being in blue. He's about to shed, so I put the humid hide in there just to help him out and make it a little bit easier for him. Their diet is one of the more fun things about hognose snakes. Not that it's super weird or unique, but these guys in the wild will eat toads and they'll eat salamanders and things like that. They will eat rodents too, I think. Westerns do anyway. Easterns probably not. But they do have an issue sometimes when they're younger switching on to rodents because they want their food to smell like a frog or even fish. A lot of people use tuna juice to scent, which is something you might need to do when they're younger. For whatever reason, all the babies that I got from Ekins here this year, they all eat pinkies just like that. No problems. I didn't have to scent them at all. I gave them a live pinky just as their first feeding, and then each of them have taken four more meals since then, and there's been no issues whatsoever. Babies, I would suggest you feed them pinky mice. That's what I would go with. And then I would suggest doing this three times a week. Adult females and adult males, I would suggest once a week or every 10 days if it's a super large individual and you're feeding them really large mice. Something that's controversial is feeding rats to hognose snakes. A lot of people say it gives them fatty livers or just fatty bodies and they don't last as long. I don't know if this is true or not, but just to err on the side of caution, I feed my female and my male both mice. I'll feed the occasional rat pup, to the female when I'm really trying to get her to gain weight after she's laid a bunch of eggs or after breeding season. But this is not a staple in her diet. Mostly it is adult mice, and this is perfect. And of course, I would suggest always frozen thawed animals all the way. Frozen thawed animals instead of live animals, because a frozen thawed animal has never bitten your snake ever in the history of everdom. One note as well, along with the frozen thawed thing, is sometimes they'll go on hunger strikes. This is pretty common with hognose snakes. Nikki here just would not eat when I got him. He would not eat. He was also sold to me as a female, by the way. So who knows how well he was eating when I first got this snake. But it took a really long time, and I scented it with toads, and I scented it with frogs, and I scented it with tuna and sardines. It was brutal. Now he's eating every time, so it's great. And he's growing really well. Even though he's 3 years old, he's still growing, which is something interesting about snakes. They do continue to grow throughout their life, although a lot less than when they're younger, of course. And also conversely, although I did say that they go on hunger strikes, these guys are pretty darn good feeders most of the time. Good try. Try to sneak away from me. They're good feeders most of the time once they're adults and they're established, to the point where some of the animals that I've had will come with their mouth open right at me as I open the tub or open the enclosure because they think it's feeding time every time. So when you're handling these guys, well, we'll get to that in a second, but be careful. Make sure they know that you're not food before you start trying to feed them or handle them. Behavior is something that you want to consider. This isn't a hognose snake. Behavior is something you want to consider when you want to get an animal, of course. And with these guys, they're a lot slower than a lot of colubrids. They're beefy. And something that's interesting, there's a few interesting things. One, they don't constrict their prey at all, which is very interesting because another colubrid such as, I don't know, a rat snake of any kind, whether it be a corn snake or king snakes or whatever, they're all going to constrict their prey, and that's how they kill their animals, subdue them, and that's how they eat. With hognose snakes, they have rear fang venom or toxic saliva, if you want to get into this debate. I would call it rear fang venom because that's what it is. All venom is a advanced saliva. And with hognose snakes, their advanced saliva, that's what I was trying to say, they have an advanced saliva, is they kind of gnawed into you, where a regular venom is like two hypodermic needles. That's how the fangs act in like an elapid, for example, or a viper. They're going to inject it into you. With a hognose snake, their advanced saliva, let's call it, is going to be gnawed into you as they gnaw their teeth back and forth, which is or the back of their mouth, and it's going to cause maybe a little bit of swelling. They've got these really cool grooves in their teeth. That's how they deliver it. It's just a really bad delivery method for toxic or toxins or venom or whatever you want to call it. But if they get their face into you, if they really sink those rear fangs into you, get them off immediately, because some people have really bad reactions where their hand will like swell up like really big. I've even seen it where people start to have blisters. This is pretty uncommon. I've heard more stories where nothing happens whatsoever except for a few drops of blood. But just in case, just not to get bit, make sure you don't smell like food and make sure that they know that you're not food when you have them out. Just kind of socialize them like that. And of course, the bluff striking is another thing you'll have to watch out for if you want to handle these animals. They'll do this with a closed mouth most of the time, which is kind of nice. But of course, you never want to just show off for your friends and, hey, look what my snake can do, and then that's the time he's going to latch on to you, right? So just be careful, respect the animal. And when they're bluff striking like that, it means that they are probably stressed and they don't want to be handled. So when they're younger, I suggest doing it day by day, just for 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 20 minutes, handling them and getting over their fear and your fear of, you know, the bluff striking thing. And then they should be good to go. Ekans here most of the time is no problem. I can pick her up. I don't use a hook to get her out. She knows it's not feeding time. Today, because there are still mice in the room from last night, one of the snakes didn't eat. She came at me with a full mouth wide open. So that's why I'm not handling her for the video. We got Sarah instead. She's a pretty cool cat too. And to round it out, to end the video, let's talk about price and availability, because you watch to this point, can you even get one? Well, we mentioned at the beginning of the video, they are illegal to keep in some places, and I've heard some other countries as well. Someone commented on a video a few weeks ago saying in Sweden it's almost impossible to get them. It's not against the law, they're just really hard to find. But then again, in the States and in Canada here, they're getting much easier to find. When I first started looking for one, when I first was getting into snakes, they were really hard to find, and they're really expensive. Just normal sometimes would go for $250. Now you can get them for about $75, and in the States, I think you can get them for a lot cheaper than that. But then they work their way up with morphs. Albinos, for example, I bought Ekans as a very baby, like we're talking 12 days out of the egg. Like she just had two meals into her, the guy said. And she was $350. So it really depends on where you are and what you're looking for, and of course albinos, and if you get a recessive gene mixed with a codominant gene, like an albino conda, for example, they're going to get up there, right? They're going to get really expensive. But because there's a bunch of recessive genes that you can breed with your hognose snakes, it means that there's going to be a lot of normal looking babies or just straight up normal babies on the market. So you're going to be able to find one without a problem basically anywhere you are in the US and Canada. And that's it. I don't really rate these animals during these care guides, but I would say hognose snakes are for sure one of the more fun ones to have. They're a great beginner animal, I think, as long as you do your research. Let me get this very clear and out of the way. If you do your research, any animal can be a good beginner animal, but hognose snakes don't have crazy parameters. As long as you understand the heat, humidity, make sure you give it water, which is something I should have put in, stuff you need to put in the cage. You need a water bowl for this animal, obviously. You're good to go. So I want to say thank you very much for watching. If you haven't already, I'd love it if you hit that subscribe button. And of course, until next week, because we do videos twice a week, that means that I'll see you on Thursday.